Nearly a year ago now, we released our first commercial game, which was Archvale. It launched on Steam, Switch, Xbox, and it was even on Xbox Game Pass day one. I documented most of the development of Archvale on YouTube over the course of a few years. In this video, I want to talk about some of the challenges we faced as we worked to finish Archvale ready for release. Making games is really difficult, and finishing games is nearly impossible. When I was making Archvale, I had it in my head that I had hard stuff to get done, and then I got to make content, and then the game was done. There's a lot of time during development where you're not making content. Sometimes you're writing the systems code. This is the backbone of systems in the game, like the inventory, crafting, combat, and cutscenes. A lot of time is spent designing nice interfaces that programmers can play with to get lots of power out of these systems when they're making content. So you could make a really nice cutscene builder class, which can create a complex set of camera pans and events with just a couple of lines of code, and that should make making content easier. UI design is another thing that you spend lots of time on, deciding how dialogue will look, and what kind of animation should happen when you click on buttons. There's also just general design decisions which take a lot of time. How often does the player find checkpoints? How does the player increase their maximum health? What things can the player do outside of fighting? How long should the boss fight take? How many rooms should there be between each reward that the player gets? And there's loads more stuff that isn't specifically content that you have to do to make a game. And all of this was really hard to do. Very challenging stuff, but it paled in comparison to how much difficulty I had just making content. To talk about making content, I need to tell you what content was in Archvale, and we had a few key types. Firstly, we had overworld areas. The overworld was a randomly generated structure, full of areas that branched into each other. Most of the game was spent exploring these areas and powering up the character with loot and items you could find in them. Every single overworld area needed to have a unique aesthetic. That usually involved having about 5 to 10 decorative assets, as well as custom lighting. Every single overworld area had a completely unique enemy set, usually 5 to 7 enemies. We never reused enemies from other areas, which meant every time we went to a new overworld area, we had a blank slate to work with. Which was actually really hard, because you had to recreate the kind of junk enemies that are like slimes. You know, these enemies just jump at you and you hit them. But we had to make a new version of that for each area, because you always want to have those kind of junk enemies that fill out the space a bit. We also had to design combat rooms, usually about 20 for each biome. Then we had to design skinned rooms for special cases, like shrines, save points, upgrade rooms. And finally, most overworld areas had a mini boss as well. Dungeons were another kind of content we had. They were handmade levels consisting of 20 to 30 rooms. They also had their very own unique enemy set. Sometimes we'd use the enemies from the biome they were in, but they would always add some additional enemies, usually 4 to 5 new enemies per dungeon. These also had a unique aesthetic, more decoration, more lighting. About 80% of the rooms in the layout would consist of combat encounters, and each of these would have 2 to 4 waves of enemies. We had to be careful and ensure that each of these waves of enemies and each of these combat encounters was actually offering a new challenge and not just repeating the same layouts and fights you had before. We needed to make sure we were mixing and matching the enemy types in some interesting ways. Each dungeon also had some kind of unique gimmick. Usually a platforming challenge was involved in it. Next, we had items, and we had an awful lot of items. We had hundreds of weapons that were spread out across a key set of weapon archetypes. We had to try and make sure that they remained unique and stood out from each other in some way, through changing up how the projectiles behaved, how the fire rate worked, damage over time effects, effects when the projectiles hit enemies, but at the same time we had to make sure we weren't making them too quirky to the point that they were like barely functional, that weapons needed to be usable. We also had a whole load of armors, all of which would change what the player looked like, and they all had their own stat bonuses, which we had to balance. Finally, we had 40 badges. Badges would provide you a unique passive effect when you equip them. We had to make sure these were interesting, and that they served the different playstyles that you could have, and we had to make sure they weren't broken, and that was a lot of work. finally, we also had special areas, which don't fit into the categories I've already said. So we had towns. These were huge. They took a lot of work. Just laying them out and placing all the decorations took ages. But not only that, they also had their very own set of massive building assets, lots and lots of unique decorations, and each town had an array of NPCs which needed dialogue. We also had shrines with unique bullet hell challenges. These were little challenges that took place on a platform where you had to dodge projectiles, and if you got hit, it would reset. Each of these had three waves, so that was three sets of challenges and 20 shrines that we had to make them for. In the end, Archvale had 7 dungeons and 10 biomes. This was done with a team of 2. Fops drew every single asset in the game, and I implemented and designed all enemies, bosses, and dungeons. In addition to us, we also had Nikki and Adrian making music, and Jake doing sound effects. And obviously, the music and sound were a massive help to make the game feel properly polished. But music and sound also creates new implementation work, so that was even more stuff on top of it. It was all this stuff, and every single one of these things had to make sounds. We had to get the music rigged up properly. It was a lot. This is a crazy amount of content for a small team. And even then, when the game came out, we had lots of people saying that the playtime wasn't long enough. It was about 6 to 12 hours, and we had complaints that this was not long enough. I wanted more. So we had a lot of content to make. But what made doing that so hard? Firstly, is that good content needs to be justified. We could very easily grab the forest biome, change a couple of sprites, and scale up the enemies to a way higher level, make them do and take more damage. And we could even, if we were feeling adventurous, add some additional projectiles to their attack patterns and things like that. And this would definitely be content, but I don't believe it's justified to exist. For me, when I added more content, I wanted to introduce new challenges, like increasing the difficulty or forcing players to approach situations in new ways. So we did that through enemies like this guy that would resurrect dead mummies, or these mushrooms that could buff each other. We had a bunch of enemy types where we tried to make sure they would interact together in some way, and we also just wanted to really ramp up the intensity of the projectile patterns as you got further. Another really difficult part about making content is keeping it consistent. As I made more stuff for Archvale, I got better at understanding what good Archvale content was. So that meant that as I got to the later game, I was making content with more experience under my belt. And suddenly, the late game was quite good, and the early game was quite bad. So I'd go back to the early game, and then suddenly the early game was better than the end game. And so I had to kind of strike this balance, and eventually you just have to cut it off, because if you keep going over things over and over and over, they will probably keep getting better. There's always room for improvement, and you'll always get better at making content. Finally, it's really hard to remain objective about your own game and understand whether the content you're making is still good. I had hundreds of hours in just the forest area. I don't think it's possible for me to have a valid opinion on the forest area anymore. The average player is going to spend 20 minutes there. The forest area was unfun to me, but I'm not sure there's a single area in any game that wouldn't become unfun if you played it for hundreds and hundreds of hours without any context. So making content isn't easy, but not only did we have a lot of content to make, but we had a limited time to do it with the funds we had. This was our full-time job, so we can't just keep delaying it forever. Of course, this means content couldn't always meet the standards I was setting for myself. I could spend 3 hours tweaking a single enemy's attack patterns, adjusting the visual and speed of the projectiles, the degree of the shot angles, the acceleration, the way the enemy moved and reacted to being hit, the speed of its animation. I'd spend hours tweaking the RGB values of an area's lighting, changing light objects' colors by tiny decimal values. I'd play a boss fight over and over again, working out the perfect amount of anticipation an attack should have before it explodes into bullets. And even after all that time, I could very easily end up unhappy with the result. That was hours and hours of work, and I could still come out the other end thinking, this still needs more work. But I had to move on. We had a deadline, we had content that needed to be in the game, good enough. But as I filled the game with good enough content, it got very hard for me to open the project. I was growing to hate Archvale, because it was full of things that I just didn't consider good enough. I think the very start of content creation is often when developers burn out of a game project, because suddenly this idea you had in your head is down on the computer, it's there in front of you, and all of that potential you thought it had has been realized, and often it's not as good as you thought it would be. And like, yeah, you could start making the next level, maybe you will, and at the same time, you have a new project already surfacing in your head, and you think the next project is going to be so much better. So it's very easy to just say, you know what, I'm moving on. If we didn't have obligations to a publisher, there's no doubt in my mind that Archvale would have been shelved during the content development phase. I was so unhappy with the project, I just couldn't wait to never see it again. However, once all of the content was there, things seemed less intimidating. I didn't like the state of the project, but every time I opened it up, I could tweak an enemy attack, or change how the decoration of an area looked, or tweak the layout of a dungeon. And every time I did something like that, the game was getting marginally better. I was no longer filling the game with stuff I didn't like, stuff that I considered incomplete, and instead the quality of the game was improving every single second I spent in the IDE. Another really challenging thing about this was that working on content was giving me a very skewed view of the whole game, and this didn't help me with really disliking Archvale when I was making it. If I was working on a boss, for me the gameplay was that I walk into the boss room and I hit the boss until it dies, and then I would think, was that fun? Was that good enough? In reality, a player experiencing this boss fight is not having that same experience. The player's prepared for the boss. They've gathered materials, they've decided what weapons they want to use, they've built a character, and this boss is like an obstacle in the way of their greater goal. They want to finish the game, they want to get this arch piece, they want to get past this mini-boss, they want to see what else is in the game. And that is context that I could just never ever feel when I was playing in isolation, these little chunks of game. It took a really long time before I felt comfortable enough to actually play through the whole game. Obviously, it's a big time commitment, that's like a day of work gone because you've decided, okay, I'm gonna play through the game today. But when I actually got to sit down and play the game, I finally realized that it was actually quite fun. And luckily I wasn't the only one that thought it was fun, because when we got our critic reviews from review websites, we had some really positive ones, and we ended up with a really good score on Metacritic. We also had some really nice reviews, which was great, because I was very worried I was going to disappoint people with this game. I'll be making more videos in the future, both about the new project we're working on, the new update we're making for Archvale, and also just talking about the process of releasing Archvale and dealing with feedback and things like that. If you want to play Archvale, it's available on Steam or the eShop or on Xbox. I believe it's leaving Xbox Game Pass soon, but if you're watching this before the 2nd of December 2022, then it'll still be up on Game Pass if you have that. Thank you very much for watching, and I will be back soon.